I have the pleasure to introduce our guest speaker this morning, who graciously came to our library out of our need for help this year. We've had a whole year of volunteers because our programming budget was cut last year for 2010, 2011, and also now for 11 and 12. And this local author was gracious enough to come here and support us. John Mariani is the food and travel columnist for Esquire magazine and wine columnist for Bloomberg News. He's been called the most influential food wine critic in the popular press by the Philadelphia Inquirer and is a three-time award nominee by the James Beard Foundation. He's also a publisher of Mariani's Virtual Gourmet Newsletter. His books include The Encyclopedia of American Food and Drink, The Dictionary of Italian Food and Drink, and with his wife Galina, The Italian American Cookbook. He received his PhD in English from Columbia University, and he lives in Tuckahoe, New York.
Thank you, Doug, and thank you everyone for showing up on this kind of dreary day, late summer day, here in Tuckahoe. I only come from Henry Street, so see a lot of familiar faces, including the person who sold me my house in 1979, and lots of others. I'm going to be talking about my new book, which has been doing very, very well. Thank heaven it's gotten very excellent reviews from the Wall Street Journal and USA Today and others. And it's in second printing. It's called How Italian Food Conquered the World, which 5 years ago I could have written How Italian Food Conquered America. But 5 years later, I can say that if you were going to New Delhi in India, if you were going to Bangkok, if you were going to Saigon, you would find that many of the new restaurants opening are in fact Italian. And if you even go to Paris, France at this point, it would be unusual if the menu did not have some form of pasta on the menu, when in fact the French, for all the reasons, some of which we will discuss, in the past completely eschewed Italian food as that food to the south, the garlic and the tomato sauce and so on. But now that's not true anymore. And there is, whereas the French used to cook so much, not exclusively, but so much with butter, that has now shifted to olive oil, for other reasons we shall get into. But let's go back. This is really a history of Italian food. There are recipes in here, but they are to illustrate what I'm talking about in the chapter. So when I write about it, when I have a recipe for marinara sauce, it's because I've just been talking about marinara sauce, which is an Italian-Americanism rather than an Italian name for a sauce. And Italian-American food is at least, if not more important to winning over the world to Italian food than regional Italian food, because regional Italian food is Umbrian food, Tuscan food, Apulian food, Sicilian food, Neapolitan food. And that kind of begins the story, because what one has to understand is that before there was an Italy in 1861, before it was a confederation of all of these 20 different provinces, from Sicily all the way up to Valdosta and on the edge of Switzerland and Germany, Austria. There wasn't such a thing as Italy, and there wasn't any such thing as Italian food, because the people who lived in Florence didn't eat anything like the people in Naples, or the people in Naples ate nothing like the people in Turin. They shared very, very little. So that if you spoke of an ancient author, like this is a 5th century Greek author, first century rather, B.C., he says, I call Italy all that peninsula which is bounded by the Ionian Gulf and the Tyrrhenian Sea and by the Alps on the landward side. That's all Italy meant. It's like talking about Asia, it's like talking about Europe. When people spoke about Italy, they just talked about this peninsula. But Italy was so fought over, so ravaged, so settled by everybody from the Greeks, to the North Africans, to the Spanish, to the French, just about everything, the Austrians occupied the north, that it was never homogeneous in any way, shape, or form, and that the food cultures from Greece and from Austria and from North Africa, are highly influenced with the people, the indigenous people in those areas ate. So that if you go back to the ancient Romans, what most ancient Romans lived on was basically gruel, porridge, some vegetables, but mainly lentils and bread. That was the diet, and they drank, they had plenty of water because of the aqueduct system of the Romans, which they built. They had plenty of water, very little meat, and they looked forward to the feast days, the sacred feast days of the Romans, as they did later the feast days under Christianity, for putting a little extra into their meals, a little more olive oil, a little more vegetables. Meanwhile, the Roman nobles, the aristocrats, the Caesars, were known for their lavishness. And the more lavish, the better, the more exotic, the stranger, the better. So they had these lavish banquets mounted by people like Apicius. And he describes, Apicius is one of the first cookbooks. Apicius himself was not a cook, but he served Apicius because all the cooks were slaves in those days. And Petronius, in Trimalchio's Feast, describes tables piled high with exotica such as porpoise, dormice, coxcombs, ostriches, sows' wombs, cranes, flamingos, and camels, all washed down with sweet-scented wine. The 3rd century emperor Heliogabalus once ordered 600 ostriches to be slaughtered for pies to be served to his banquet guests, and supposedly fattened the vats of eels with the meat of Christians slain in the Colosseum. These were weird, gluttonous people. Which leads you to realize that the story of the nursery rhyme about 4 and 20 blackbirds baked in a pie was not a dainty dish to set before the king was actually true. This is the type of thing that they would do. But again, 99% of Italians and 99% of the world didn't eat anything close to that. As we move forward in history, and as the Roman Empire breaks down, things don't get much better. The priests and brothers and nuns ate slightly better in their abbeys and convents because the people and the landlords would bring, it was considered that something you had to do for the church to bring food to them. But since they had about 200 fast days a year, and up until the rule of Saint Benedict, they were only allowed one meal a day, which is usually bread and a little milk or something, they weren't exactly getting fat like Friar Tuck either. As we move through the centuries, various city-states, especially Venice, grow rich. And you know, the story of history is not most of us who went through grammar school and high school learned the so-called great man theory of history. Caesar, Napoleon, Hitler, Stalin, these are the men who moved history, Attila the Hun, whatever. Well, the thing that was actually moving them was always, always food. Attacks come from the west, attacks come from the east. You take over a country not to enslave it for any particular reason except that there's food to be had there. And Italy was called a plate of soup surrounded by too many spoons because everybody was invading it. And the Greeks called Italy Enotrulia, which means the land of grapes, the land of wine. Eno means wine, the land of wine, because there were so many wine grapes there. And this stuff could be exported and sent around the Mediterranean. And after the Crusades, although the Crusades originally started as a religious war, it was not lost upon any of the Crusaders or the popes or anybody else that there were riches to be had in the Orient, that is the Middle East in those days, not least spices. It is unimaginable to us now how spices, which come on those little tins at the supermarket, or fresh herbs that you would pound and make into spices, how extraordinarily profitable they were at one time in history. And to have a lock, as did Venice, because Venice, after the Crusades, Venice was right there. Here's the Middle East, and here's Venice, or a few people, Middle East is here, and Venice is here. And they had the best ships and the most ships, and Venice was always very smart. They didn't like to go to war. They used to like to make contracts. Anything not to go to war was good. And of course they made contracts and bargains with good men and bad, but they, from approximately the 12th, 13th century onward, for another 300-400 years, Venice controlled the spice trade throughout Europe and grew immensely, immensely rich. This, in turn, made others, both in Italy and outside of Italy, say, well, how do we get in on this? I mean, but they dominate us, so we can't challenge them up there in the north of the Ionian and Sea, so we've got to find another way. We've got to find trade routes to the east and to the Orient. And one Italian named Marco Polo got all the way to China and spent 14 years there and came back and wrote of his travels. He actually dictated it. They immediately sent him to prison because he joined the war on the part of Genoa. And Genoa lost, so they threw him in jail, and he dictated his memoirs to a French guy, a French prisoner. So they originally published in French. What he told of Asia and of China was the travel guide or everything that was known to Europeans until the 1800s, because nobody else really got over there. And one of the things he says is this: you cannot believe the food culture that they have over there and how they spice. And to get rid of one myth, I'll demolish several, but one myth about, well, you know, the Europeans used to put tons of spices on their food because the food itself wasn't very good, the meat and the fish. This is getting it backwards. Spices were so expensive that the last thing you would do is to douse a piece of bad meat or fish with spices because you couldn't afford to do so. I mean, to this day, saffron is probably the most expensive thing in the whole world, more so than gold or uranium. Another thing that Michael and that Marco Polo did was to bring rice to Europe. And although it wasn't very popular, people scratched their heads as to what to do with it. Even the Italians, they planted it a bit around the Po Valley. But they didn't take to it immediately. What he did not bring back, he did not bring back pasta or macaroni or noodles or spaghetti. What he said was, and the book is here in the library, you can read his travels, he said, hey, you won't believe what I found over there. They're eating macaroni and spaghetti just the way we are here in Italy for the last several hundred years. That myth was propagated by a spaghetti company, which said that, for reasons that escape me, he would bring such a thing back from the Orient, which is simply not true. Pasta, noodles have been known since Roman times. They weren't exactly what we think of now. Pasta just means paste, anything made with a paste. And there is some evidence that the northern Africans, the Arabs, brought this, what they call ikliya, to Sicily. And to this day, there are certain pastas which have a very, very similar name to tiglia in Sicily, which might have something to do with their bringing it there. However, Italy and the rest of Europe was still, for the most part, starving, and that as of the late Middle Ages and the early Renaissance, when, again, ships, transport, brought more food, now you had dried and salted foods and fish that could be brought from one port to another, you had spices and so forth, you could ship, because of the establishment of roads, you could ship wine, it wasn't very good wine, but you could ship it all over. And when you have, after Marco Polo, in the late 1400s, have Vasco da Gama going around the Horn to India, and other explorers who tried to go that way, and that's a long trip around Africa to get to India. That's the only thing they knew. So some, by the way, you know, people, another myth is that people did not believe the world was flat in those days. Most educated people knew it was round. And so, the textbook version, the child's version of Columbus sailing forth and thinking he was going to fall off the end of the earth was simply not true. He knew that it was round, but he had no idea what was out there. He did hope that he was going to find a route, the spice route, to the east. He wasn't looking for gold, he wasn't looking to propagate Christianity. All he was after was spices again, which puts into perspective what I was saying about how expensive spices were. Well, he got to the Americas, and he didn't find much in the way of spices. What he did find, however, and started to send back to Europe, he and other explorers were the potato, corn, raspberries, strawberries, chili peppers, and the tomato. Now, imagine Indian food or even Italian food without the chili pepper. Imagine if any of the restaurants here in town go across, right across the street, the Indian restaurant, and you assume that that's what they've been cooking with for thousands and thousands of years. It is indigenous to India or Bangkok or whatever. Well, no. No Indian cook ever laid eyes on a chili pepper until approximately the 17th century. So too, the tomato, the basis of Italian food, tomato sauce, red sauce, tomatoes and everything. No Italian ever saw a tomato before the 17th century. And when it was brought over, botanists said, well, what is this? It was really a fruit, it wasn't even a vegetable. And it was a member of the deadly nightshade family. So they said, if you eat this, it's poisonous. So they fed it basically to hogs and cattle. But the people in the southern part of Italy, where it grew, it just propagated itself. You know, you throw some tomato seeds in some dirt and you're gonna get tomatoes. And because the southern part, especially around Naples, it grew so well, they started eating it and they said, don't tell anybody else, but tomatoes are really great. But we're talking about the 17th century. Nobody in Europe was eating tomatoes in the late 17th or even the early 18th century, except the southern Italians. The northern Italians weren't eating them. What happened with tomatoes was that as the southern Italians, specifically around Marzano and Naples, when canning came in the early 19th century, and the Italians had a great deal to do with perfecting canning, as did Napoleon's agronomist, when you have tin cans, that means you can ship perishable products like tomatoes. So they canned the tomatoes, they started shipping them north, so it was not until the middle of the 19th century that northern Italians or anybody else ate tomatoes. The first instances of tomato sauce we don't even hear about until the late 18th and early 19th century. So there's another myth, more or less, to speak of that, due to the identity of the tomato with Italian food is inextricable. It is not. What were they eating then at that time? Well, Charles Dickens, the novelist, spent a year in Italy from 1844 to 1845, and he described the food that he got. The only place you could eat if you were a traveler were these wayside stops, these taverns, these inns, all over Europe. And they used to place about 25 miles from one another, because that's about how far a horse could go in those days, just as the caravans in the Middle East were all when they set up in oases to go every 25 miles, because that's how far a camel could go in one day. So when he would visit, I mean, it was just horrible, horrible food. He describes some of the food he ate outside of Genoa. He had tagliatini, coxcomb, sheep's kidneys, some pieces of some unknown part of a calf served with white bait. And he had cabbage boiled with a great deal of rice and a tureen full of water flavored with cheese. And two little red turkeys, stew of garlic and truffles. And the usual dinner he was getting was vegetable and rice soup in need of plenty of grated cheese, lots of salt, and abundance of black pepper. And he got a bit of roast beef the size of a small French roll and five withered apples all huddled together on the plate, crowding upon each other as if they were trying to save itself from the chance of being eaten. Well, as he headed south, he said that the poor of the countryside were just totally impoverished. And he says that the southern landlords claimed everything the peasants tilled. Those who worked the land would be punished if they were caught eating white bread, because it meant they'd stolen the landlord's wheat from the harvest. And to avoid this punishment, the peasants waited till the crops were harvested. And what they did was, and the pure crazy thing is, this become quite chic today, they picked up whatever was left of the grains of wheat, and they would toast them. And by toasting them, the landlord would say, well, they just burned this stuff. But they were actually toasting when making their own kind of bread and putting them into their pastas and so forth. Various people who visited Italy at that time, and this would have been certainly true of the potato, by the way, Irish potatoes. Irish eat nothing but potatoes, love those potatoes. Irish never saw a potato until the 19th century, but it did take propagation very, very well, so that the poor Irish did live on potatoes, which has a high source of only one or two, like niacin and a couple of other things in it. Potatoes are very good, but you cannot live exclusively on them. So they develop terrible diseases, just as Northern Italian, especially among children, were getting pellagra because they were taking cornmeal, which came originally from America, and they were eating polenta three times a day. And that's all they were eating. So they developed terrible diseases of deficiency at that time. And in 1845, when the potato crop fails in Ireland, all of Ireland is thrown into a horrible famine, which forced more Irish live in America, more Irish live in New York City today than do in Dublin. Matter of fact, there were more people in Dublin in the 19th century than live in Dublin today. That's how many got out. When George Washington Carver, who had slavery in his own background, when he went to Sicily and saw Italian children working in salt mines and coal mines at 12 years old, he says, the Negro of America is not the farthest person down in the world. It is the Italians of the South. This is the kind of poverty that led to the Great Escape. And I'll give you a small anecdote of my own family, that when my maternal great-grandmother, Maria Grazia, was a little girl in the companion town of Laurina, she worked for a wealthy padrone, for the landlord, and just a little girl. One day he beat her unconscious, and the local doctor threatened that if the girl died, he would see to it that Il Signore would be prosecuted to the full extent of the law. Her infraction? She was a moment late opening the door for a guest at the master's home. It's not unusual, her story. So you have poverty, and you have stories like this with no hope under the landlord. It's a feudal system, no hope of getting out of it. There was nothing to look forward to except for one thing. Steamships now carried people to America. So the Irish went, the Germans went, the Russians went, the Jews went, everybody went to America. And from 1880 to 1925, 5 million Italians came to America, most of whom went through Ellis Island, where the first sign they saw, if they could read English, which they couldn't, was, "We do not charge for food here." And it wasn't quite clear if that means all of America or just in Ellis Island, but they were prepared with their meager pennies to buy food. Many, many people in this audience, I assume, from Italian-American background, have similar stories to my great-grandmother and how their parents or grandparents came here, and both what they suffered, but what they also flourished, so that in a very few years, the Italians were flourishing in tenements in the Lower East Side and in Brooklyn and the Bronx and so forth. But they did have much more food because in the old country, they were spending 75% of their income on food. And most of it bought from the landlord, from food that they themselves had raised. Here, they were only spending 25% of their income. It's an astonishing gap. 25% versus 75%. This allowed my great-grandfather, who was a plasterer, to go out in the morning with a veal chop under his belt, while the kids were eating bread and they had pasta two or three times a week. And Italians were not starved. One thing, they were in poverty. There's no question about that. They were very poor. But hunger was something that had been beaten back. And as the time went on, and our forebears got good jobs, thrived, and became mayors of New York City and governors of the state and so forth, and well-educated, and doctors, lawyers, and writers, and so forth, the Italians did flourish. And Italian-American food, which was an adaption of, and I want to emphasize this, what we know as Italian-American food is almost exclusively Southern Italian food, south of Rome, most specifically Neapolitan, and Sicilian. And I dare say that if I asked, well, let me ask, first of all, how many of you are from Italian background here? Okay, plenty. How many are from Neapolitan or Campania background? How many are from Sicilian background? Okay, so that's about, takes in about all of you. Northern Italians did move to other parts of the country, specifically to San Francisco, where they dominated the boat industry and the fishing industry there. They moved to Southern Italians, specifically Sicilians, moved to Louisiana because after the Civil War, the former black slaves did not want to pick cotton anymore. And so the cotton plantation owners had seen crates of lemons coming from Sicily with pictures of figures of people picking the lemons off the trees. And they said, if these people pick lemons, they'll pick cotton if they need a job. And that's how the Sicilians came to Louisiana, where they thrived, and within very few years, they dominated the fruit-picking industry in Louisiana. Others went to Boston, Rhode Island, Chicago, even in the Midwest, specifically St. Louis, and other places, and they brought with them, largely speaking, this Italian-American cuisine, which was largely based on the tomato because they were Southern, and did have Parmigiano cheese and their favorite types of a lot of eggplant and so forth. So again, if we were to take all of us and go across the street, or any of the 200 or 300 Italian restaurants we have in Tuckahoe, we would see basically the Italian American menu that was created back at the turn of the last century. The pizza was created in Italy, in Naples, and they knew it as a flatbread, like pita bread. They knew it as a flatbread, but what really happened was an occasion of style, or style and substance. In 1889, the new queen of the new Italy, Queen Margherita, came to Naples, and they had a pizza contest. And one enterprising guy, whose name was Raffaele Esposito, who worked for a pizzeria called Brandy, which is still in existence in Naples, he created a pizza that had the colors of the new Italian flag, white mozzarella, red tomato, and green basil, and presented it. She loved it, apparently. It became hit the news, and they called it, of course, Pizza alla Margherita, which is what you'll find across the street, or down the block here, or down the block there. That's where the Pizza Margherita came from. 1905, we know when the first pizzeria opened in New York. It's still there. It's called Lombardi's, G. Lombardi's. It's on Spring Street in the Village. It still has the original coal oven. I think they might have moved a couple of doors down, but it's still there. So the pizza did not come from New Haven. one of the things back in the old country that made Italian food over there, because as I said, there was Ligurian food and Varese food and so forth, was that, again, most people did not know how to read or write. But an enterprising fellow from the silk trade retired, his name was Arturo Pellegrini. And Pellegrini retired, said, what am I going to do with my life now? He said, I'll write a cookbook. And he wrote a cookbook in the Tuscan dialect of the time, brought it to various publishers. It was very, very complete. I'm sure we probably have it here. Pellegrini Ottuzzo, and he was very complete, and he gave it to several publishers, and they said, who would buy a cookbook? Because the only cookbooks written before that were for the noble families and their kitchens. Okay? Those the only, everybody had their moms and dads, and they knew how to cook, but they couldn't read anyway, so why cook? Well, there was an emerging middle class after 1860s and the 1880s, and Italians were becoming more educated. So he said, well, I'll publish it myself. And he dedicated it to his cats, just for something to do. Well, within 20 years, that had sold over 250,000 copies. And it was the most popular book sold in Italy, along with I Promessi Sposi by Mancini, a novel, a romantic novel of Italian life. And those two books had enormous influence on Italians' reading. And because Pellegrino Artusi's book was written in the Tuscan dialect, that really became the Italian that people read and which was taught in the schools. So it had a really great, and he mentions things like meatballs. He barely mentions a tomato sauce at all because, again, being a Tuscan, he was not particularly interested in that. Well, to leap again over the pond, Italian restaurants after the pizza day. What happened was the Italian restaurateurs were anxious to make more money and not just serve pizzas to their Italian friends in Little Italy and so forth. Arthur Avenue, you know, which is still the thriving Little Italy. You know how Arthur Avenue became Italian, the Belmont section of the Bronx? It was because when they were building the Bronx Zoo and the Botanical Gardens, if you think of those structures, what do they need to build them? Stonemasons. And that's why Arthur Avenue is Italian, because the stonemasons went up there. I go down there every week, at least once a week, to shop. And they're primarily Neapolitan and some Sicilian down there. Well, they expanded on the pizzeria idea because non-Italians seem to take to Italian food. It's very savory stuff. Americans like tomatoes. Tomato came from America and all these other things. And what's better than melted cheese and tomato sauce on top of pounded chicken or veal? And the pizzerias, is interesting, tried to move away from the image of just being pizza sellers. And if you go to Arthur Avenue, for instance, there's a place there called Mario's, which opened in 1919, as just a window where it sold pizzas. And after a while, it became more successful, it became a ristorante. And now they only serve pizzas. They serve them at lunch, you can have a pizza, but you could have one at dinner, but only if you order something else, because you know we have moved away from being a lowly pizzeria, now we are a restaurant. The irony is, of course, is that the most stylish item on any menu in America, whether it's an American menu or anything else, is now pizza. I haven't opened a menu. I get to 20 cities a year in the United States. I haven't opened a menu that does not have pizza on it, no matter what kind of restaurant it is, unless it's Chinese or something like that. They have flatbreads, they call them all kinds of things. But pizza has just conquered the world all on its own, aside from the Italian food overall. So, brief mention should be made of Mussolini, who did a lot of really bad things and very, very, very few things of good. And one of the things he did try to do was to increase the population after World War I of especially male Italians, because they lost a lot of troops, lost a lot of males in World War I, and so many people had emigrated to America. As a matter of fact, it broke the landlord system. It disappeared in Italy because they didn't have any more guys to run the farms. So the landlords were out of luck. Mussolini encouraged Italian women to have as many children as possible. The church thought this was a great idea too. And one of the things he did do was to try to increase the amount of food stuffs available to people, especially wheat. He called it the battle for wheat, in order to have more food, so we have bigger families and so forth. That's about all he did right. He himself, by the way, was very dyspeptic and had an ulcer and didn't eat much of anything at all. As you know, he was eventually joined with Hitler. Mussolini was the inspiration for Hitler rather than vice versa, but they both ended rather badly. Mussolini with his mistress hung upside down in the town square, riddled with bullets, well deserved. He also decided that Italy should have ocean liners, the equivalent of the French and German and British ocean liners that crossed the Atlantic, hoping also to cash in a bit on American tourism. So he built two beautiful ocean liners, one called the Rex and one called, I forget what it's called, but it was equally as beautiful and stylish. But if you look at the menus were half Italian and half American. So you could get linguine with clam sauce, or spaghetti with tomato sauce, but on the other side you could also get turkey with stuffing, and salad with Russian dressing, and even bananas and so forth, because it was specifically for American trade. If you want to see a very funny movie, Charlie Chaplin's The Great Dictator, in which Chaplin impersonates Hitler, and wonderful actor, impersonates Mussolini. They have a fight in the middle of the picture, and Mussolini is throwing a big plate of spaghetti at Hitler, kind of typical of the time. Another thing typical of the time, starting in the 30s, is something that hasn't ended yet, and it causes me an enormous amount of agita. really, is that the image of Italian food, Italian restaurants, has been so linked with the mob and with the mafia that it has become almost inescapable, despite the fact that it is complete nonsense. But it began back in the 30s with brutal movies, some very good movies, like Scarface and Little Caesar. Isn't it interesting that Little Caesar was later used for the title of a pizzeria chain, as is Godfather Pizzeria. What amazes me is that Herman Cain, who was still running for president, I guess, was running for president, he was the present CEO of Godfather Pizza, did wonders with it. Now here's a African-American man promoting an Italian product, which is fine, but it's called Godfather Pizza. Can you imagine would he have a step and fetch it fried chicken chain? I don't think so, you know? To me, it's more than ironic. It's kind of despicable. The mob movies kind of died out in World War II because Italians had to look good in foxholes and they're not supposed to be mobsters. In the 50s, you have some movies like Al Capone. It's always Al Capone, the big fat guy who's always eating spaghetti, and swigging wine. Boorish people, very low class, but always associated with Italian restaurants. And then you have two masterpieces, and they really are, which is The Godfather and Goodfellas, in which the food is absolutely essential to understanding these characters. The really good Italian food movie, of course, is Big Night. It's a lovely, charming, sweet movie about two brothers, Italian brothers who open a restaurant in New Jersey in the 1950s and find that their customers don't want to eat anything they want to cook, and what their customers do want them to cook is completely unknown to them. Chicken parm, and spaghetti and meatballs, the versions of that, you know, they knew back in Italy. But so many things that Italians came here and said, they opened the menu and, what is this? Never heard of this. Chicken scappariello, chicken Vesuvio, clams Posillipo. I mean, what is Posillipo? Is a town. I come from that town. We don't have anything named that. And Sorrento, what is this? Spaghetti alla Sorrentina? I come from Sorrento and we don't have anything back. So it was kind of a mix and match sort of idea. But those two movies, the famous line, The Godfather, get rid of the gun, but take the cannoli. It's a good laugh. It is a masterpiece. But I, to this day, and probably many of you, still, when I go out with friends who are not Italian to an Italian restaurant, I say, this place connected? I said, no, it's not. And it's a despicable question, which was really parlayed into what I consider a horror of a series, which was The Sopranos, in which all they do is these gluttonous, wretched criminals who are made romantic in some way. They go into one restaurant, that's 13, and then one episode, a dozen of them around the table, and they eat, and then they leave like a $100 tip. And the waiter complains, and they just shoot him in the parking lot. You know, this is the way Italian, I guess all Italians do that. That's the way we operate, right? Pretty awful stuff. Fortunately, Americans were getting another image in the 1950s from Italian movies, that is, movies made in Italy. The early 50s, it was movies like The Bicycle Thief and Open City, which showed people really starving and doing anything to keep their families together. But then you had a series of movies which were made in Hollywood, Three Coins in the Fountain, Light in the Piazza, a number of others which showed, Summertime, in which Katharine Hepburn goes to Venice as a spinster and finds Rosano Brazzi, who appeared in every one of these movies. Every single one was Rosano Brazzi putting the moves on some woman of a certain age who is an American, like a Katharine Hepburn. And they always end badly, and he's always married, and Rosanna, why didn't you tell me? But they were sweet movies because they were taking place in the reborn Italy after World War II, what they called Il Boom. And if you look at those movies, there are not many people in the streets because there weren't many tourists. But they were. They were sipping espresso, and there's Gregory Peck with on his Vespa with Audrey Hepburn going down the Via Veneto. It was terrific stuff. And so Americans say, hey, it's not all poverty and gangsters. This is a, and the food looks terrific, and they're drinking this red wine and dancing in the moonlight. So that was all very good. And then at the end of the 50s, you have the Fellini movies like La Dolce Vita, which is a term that has entered the language worldwide to mean that's how Italians appreciate life, you know, La Dolce, the sweet life, even though it was a very sardonic movie. But to have Marcello Mastroianni and Claudia Cardinale and Sofia Loren and Virna Lisi, and in the case of La Dolce Vita, Anita Ekberg, in the Trevi Fountain. I mean, these are iconic images that so radically changed this dirty, low-class, greaser, guinea-wop, dago red image of the past, that it was really amazing. Two surprising things happened. They invented the jet plane airliner, which allowed anybody to fly over to Italy and France and Germany and London very cheaply. And also a man named Arthur Frommer published a book called Europe on $5 a Day, which was really, you could do it. I did it. Your knapsack, you get a $2 pensione, a dollar for lunch, a dollar for dinner, you still got a dollar left over for the uffizi, you know. This and the airplane, that jet plane, the Boeing 707, did more for people, not only for Italy, but for France and those other countries, to go and learn what Europe was really like in the post-war period, and to fall in love with real Italian food, so that people could be like, why doesn't the food here taste like it does there? Because this is Italian-American food. It has its own culture to it, and it can be very good. But the reason it wasn't very, very good as it was back there, was because we didn't have the same ingredients. Simple as that. We didn't have real Parmigiano. The USDA kept out prosciutto, the true prosciutto. You could have various aspects of it made here. You didn't find much imported pasta. Olive oil was terrible in the stuff. I remember my mother cooking with, you know, the big tin, but you never know where it came from. It said packed in Italy. That's all it meant. It could have come from anywhere. We just put into the can in Italy. Things like very expensive things like balsamic vinegar and white truffles, these were unavailable here. What changed that was another jet airplane story, which was DHL and FedEx. So these things became available, readily available in the United States, and as of 1980 or so, with an increased import of really wonderful Italian wines, not Riuniti on ice, so nice, not the Chianti and the straw Fiaschi, but really excellent wines, Barbarescos and Barolos and Chianti Classicos and Brunello di Montalcinos, which were written about in the popular press. And so all of a sudden you had all of this coming, so there wasn't any longer any excuse for Italian food in this country to be different from the Italian food in that country. And you started to have much higher end Italian restaurants opening. Restaurants that eschewed the red checkered tablecloth, and instead they put frette linens on top. The wine glasses were thin and fine, they weren't just little tumblers. So the image changed. And Italian design had a lot to do with that. The image changed so that we were growing closer to what was happening over there in terms of the food and the way they serve food and the way they appreciate food and La Dolce Vita. And at the same time, but now in the mid-1980s, I have a whole chapter about this called Flash in the Pan. An astonishing thing took place, which had nothing specifically to do with Italian food, but it interacted. And that was when international fashion changed radically, turned away from French fashion to Italian fashion, specifically sportswear, in the mid-80s. And they were talking about Ferragamo, you're talking about Armani, you're talking about Dolce & Gabbana, so forth. So all of these wonderful, wonderful Missoni, so forth, Cavalli. These were replacing the French in the eyes of the kind of clothes that people really want to wear. these fashions were being shown on the runways in the Milan fashion shows. So Anna Wintour of Vogue and the head buyer for Bloomingdale's and all of the European fashion editors and buyers from Harrods and London's were going to Milan in the mid-80s and going to see the runway shows with these gorgeous Italian models in these sexy clothes, not that stiffness that was in the Parisian shows. And I did some interviews with the book, and they said, you know, in Paris you go and you go to the show and then immediately you take out your order book and you write up, that's it. In Italy, what they did was Armani and Missoni and Ferragamo, let me take you to my favorite trattoria here in Milano, most of which have to be Tuscan and Milanese. And so, as one of the couple of people say, says, you know, you'd go into a place like Bice, and I'd be having lunch with the person from Ferragamo, and over at the next table was somebody from Dolce & Gabbana having lunch with the editor from Vogue. And then the next day, it'd be switched around at other places. So everybody fell in love with the food, the style, the take your time, we'll write the orders later. This hit the fashion pages, and Vogue was very, very important to me in this respect. This hit the fashion pages with photographs of these Italian models on Vespas, drinking cappuccino, having gelati, going down the Via Veneto, photographed by the best photographers of the time. Very, very sexy stuff in Capri and yachts and so forth. This now turned the once low-class Italian food into chic, cool, wonderful. Everybody wants to eat this. So that when Bice, which was originally in Milan, opened a place on 54th Street, right off 5th Avenue, right down the street from, right up the street from Saks Fifth Avenue and so forth, Bill Blass went to eat there on opening day. And he's quoted in here, and he ordered a bottle of San Pellegrino, and he had this wonderful pasta. And it was the middle of July, and it was very, very hot, and the air conditioning wasn't working too well on opening day. And he just said, and he reported to the New York Times, he was interviewed, and he says, oh, this is the way people want to eat today. Ba-boom! You know, when you have that kind of imprimatur of Italian food from a guy like Bill Blass, who knows taste and style and so forth, this had enormous effect. So that if you now go to an Italian restaurant in America, or any place else, 50% of the stuff on there is going to be Italian-American, but the other 50% is going to be closer to what you find regionally in Italy. So things like tiramisu, for instance, which comes out of Trentino, that does in fact come over there. Burrata cheese, the sauce sent to mozzarella. You never saw that before, but what you really didn't see was five different types of extra virgin olive oil, three different types of aged balsamic vinegar, the true, real prosciutto di Parma, several varieties of it, true Parmigiano cheeses you've never seen before. And now these, now you're seeing a steak alla Fiorentina on the menu, and gnocchi alla Romana, and so forth. Things that were not available before are now on menus here and abroad. Lots more ravioli under different names, lots more agnolotti and stuffed pastas. Now, of course, the French, catching wind of this, as I said, they started to use a lot more, especially in the south of France, a lot more olive oil, but they all caught wind of this. But they couldn't make lasagna or cannelloni. They just couldn't bring themselves to make them like an Italian would. So what do they stuff truffles and foie gras into it. And that made it French. And the more complicated, if you ever look at the same exact recipe for, let's say, cannelloni in an Italian cookbook, it's 1.5 pages. In a French cookbook, it's 6 pages. You have to make a broth, and you have to do this, you have to cook that, like foie gras, you have to force meat, then you mix with this, it goes through, and then you roll it, and you do that, whatever. It's, that's typically French, and it still is to this day. But they're catching on. Carpaccio, which came out of Harry's Bar, there's a whole great story about the original Harry's Bar, which invented the Bellini and Carpaccio, which is ubiquitous now. And then there's the story of pasta primavera, which is basically pasta with vegetables. That is an Italian that isn't even Italian-American. That was created with Sirio Maccioni, who is a Tuscan who owns the Sirp restaurant in New York. He just tossed it together for Craig Claiborne of the New York Times while they were not in the restaurant. He was at his house or something. Craig Claiborne says, this is the best pasta I ever had. He says, well, it's just stuff I had in the refrigerator, some carrots and cauliflower and put a little cream in it and so forth. I said, well, it's great. He prints the recipe in the New York Times. It becomes the most famous Italian pasta in the world. So now if you go to Moscow, you're going to find pasta primavera. But if you go to Florence and ask for pasta primavera, they say, what is that? Oh, that thing, oh, that stuff you Americans eat, yeah. Fettuccine Alfredo, what is that? Fettuccine Alfredo was created in Rome at the around World War I by a guy named Alfredo at a restaurant. And his wife had no appetite after she had her first baby. And wanting to have a healthy wife and more babies, Alfredo made this dish of fettuccine with butter and cheese, no cream. But the best butter he could find, the best cheese, she leapt out of bed, ate 16 portions of it, had 10 more children. And in the 1920s, Douglas Fairbanks Jr. and his new wife, Mary Pickford, came to Italy, ate at Alfredo's, brought the news back to America about fettuccine Alfredo. And within a year, there was a recipe in a Los Angeles cookbook for fettuccine Alfredo, which became, again, ubiquitous in America. But if you went to ask for fettuccine Alfredo in Naples or Palermo, they just scratch their head and say, I'm sorry, maybe spiace, I don't know what you're talking about. Okay. So, since we only have a couple of minutes, what you had, the change, came because the ingredients got better, Italian food became more fashionable, and then in the 1990s, this heavy, greasy, oily, carbo-rich, this food that's going to just kill you, the Center for Science and the Public Interest came out and called fettuccine Alfredo heart attack on a plate. Well, you know, it doesn't sound very appetizing. What happened in the 1990s, and this clinches the deal, is that the Mediterranean diet comes out in all the newspapers, that what the Mediterraneans eat is healthier, that includes Italians, much healthier than what we're eating here in America, or what the French are eating in France. And if you look at the Italian diet, they don't eat all that much, and they eat more fish, and they do it simply, and they don't put cream sauces on. So the Mediterranean diet had an enormous influence. That was the clincher. So here you had food everybody liked in the first place, all over the world, but regarded it as low class. Then it became made with the best ingredients. Then it became fashionable, and lastly, the stuff's good for you too. It's all right to smoke cigarettes. I mean, that's basically what the Mediterranean diet was coming out and saying, that this stuff is good for you, helpful. So take those five elements, all of which are richly described in this tiny little book here, which is available for sale over there, made Italian food not just popular, but it really has conquered the world, so that at this point, the most stylish restaurants in any city are likely to be Italian. And there's a quote in there from a woman who writes for the New Delhi Times in India, and she says, anyone notice that nobody is opened up a French restaurant? It's all Italian, Italian, Italian. And it's true, even in India. So thank you for coming. I shall answer questions as long as Debbie likes me to, or sign books as long as... Yes. I only really have two I really like a lot. One is Mario's, which I mentioned, and the other is Roberto's, around the corner, which is a much different kind of restaurant. I think that Tra de Noi does some nice things. Some of the others I really don't like at all. And then there are others like Anna and Tony's, which is, you know, you can get that food anywhere. Nothing wrong with it, nothing extraordinary about it. Yes?
Speaking of health, what do you think of these high-fiber pastas they sell now?
Maybe they're healthy. I don't know. They don't taste very good. They just don't taste very good.
Is that Italy? Is that a region, a certain region that represents?
Italy? You mean the big
one.
Big supermarket?
Yeah, yeah.
That started as part of the slow food movement, which I talk about in the book, in Piedmont, in outside of Turin. And it opened there first based on the principles that the best ingredients provide the best and most healthful food. Also happened to be the most expensive. The first one with money from Italy open here in New York. They're going to be in Los Angeles. They're going to be in D.C. They're going to be the Trader Joe's of Italian food. Yes.
I was wondering if you thought that the popularity of the Food Network, particularly Mario Batali, Lydia Bus, well, she's not on that, but Giada or what, whether that furthered the interest in Italian food, or basically it was there because the interest was already there. You know, what was the relationship between these chefs becoming superstars in the food industry?
They followed the emerging popularity in the 1990s and made it much, much more so. I give them an enormous amount of credit, not least Mario Batali and Lydia, who is on the PBS. They're wonderful shows. Giada is very, very good. I think they're better than most of the other shows on the various TV food networks, which have descended into just, you know,
junk.
Do you know anything about a dish called spadini alla romana?
Yeah.
Okay, it's very hard to find in a lot of places.
There's a place in Brooklyn
called Four Corners or New Corners. They've changed their name every Monday or Tuesday.
Yeah. Spadini alla romana, which you will find in Rome. It used to be everywhere, but it's kind of a little difficult to think. Basically, it's just mozzarella with little squares of bread on a skewer. That's what the spiedino is. And then it is fried in olive oil, and then served usually either with an anchovy sauce or a tomato sauce. I think that you could probably go almost any of the Italian restaurants in here in Tuckahoe and ask them to make it for you with 5 hours notice, and they would. But it's very easy to make at home.
Has immigration from Eastern Europe, Asia, and Africa influenced Italian cooking in Italy today? Are there any new directions or additions of food items?
No. The Italians have, there's been a lot of immigration, but the Italians have stalwartly said, we're perfectly happy with our regional food. When I was in Turin several weeks ago, I had great Piemontese food for 4 or 5 days, but I was kind of feeling like maybe a little tomato sauce or something like that. And then I said, are there any Sicilian Neapolitan restaurants here in town? They said, why would you want that here? We're in Turin. They're very happy with their food and a little bit stuck in the mud about that. The influence of Albanians, Croatians, Slovenians here has been enormous. One of the ways that they, as with most immigrants, the easiest way to become accepted into a new society, and America proves this, is enter the restaurant business, the grocery business. We have Korean grocers now, you have German Rathskellers, Jewish delis, that's the way you get into a country. And the Albanians have entered into Italian food very, very big time.
In Arthur Avenue also.
Oh yeah, they own a lot of the real estate there too. Yeah, they do. Yes?
Yes, my grandmother came here from Italy in 1912, and I grew up saying I want to put gravy on my spaghetti.
Yeah.
Was that something that, how did that come about that my Irish friend said sauce and I said gravy?
Gravy seems to have been adopted as a term
in America.
Yeah. We didn't use that specifically in my family, but they talked more about Sunday gravy. That was the Sunday, because grandma or mom spent all day cooking it, which is the opposite of marinara sauce, huh?
People called it ragu.
Ragu, yeah. The ragu is the long cooked sauce, whereas the marinara is something that takes about 20 minutes to make.
As a matter of fact, I wanted to ask you about the marinara. I was under the impression that they made it in Naples, and you could use marinara sauce without cooking it, and I tried it, because the wives used to wait for the mariners to come home.
That's exactly right.
They in Naples. Mm-hmm. And if you just use the olive oil, garlic, basil, the crushed tomatoes, mm-hmm. leave it on the stove for a couple of hours.
Well, the story that I heard, which is slightly more romantic, is that they saw their husbands coming on the horizon, and they put a big cauldron on the beach, and they throw all those ingredients in, and then they took the fish that they weren't going to, seafood they were not going to sell, and they put it in there, and that would be their breakfast at 8, 9 o'clock in the morning. But that's why it is called marinara, yeah.
Are there any stars of Italian cuisine in Italy today that are taking a lead role?
There are some who are trying to do what's called nuovo cucina, which is more, on the one hand, it's more Frenchified, it's more delicate, it's more refined. And there's one or two doing the so-called molecular cuisine stuff, but they are very few. I would say they're on half a dozen in all of Italy. They have some TV stars, Alfredo Viazzi, I think his name is, Bisani rather. They have some TV stars over there cooking, young guys, but, well, I probably should stop, or Debbie, am I on the edge? I guess so. Well, thanks for coming.
Thank you.